Hello and welcome to this episode of the AppDevANGLE. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I am the practice lead for the AppDev practice at theCUBE Research. I'm joined today by Jackie and Bob. How you doing, guys?
Good morning.
Good morning, Paul.
Good to have you here. So we have a lot to talk about today. Cisco Live in EMEA. What's happening in that space? They've showcased it, their simplicity, security, and AI readiness. The company really was really had a lot of people here. There's 17,000 attendees where they talked about new innovations that showcase the IT space around building, securing, and operating AI-ready data centers, and looking at future-proofing workplace and prioritizing digital resilience. There was also a big emphasis around skill programs and sustainability and engineering alliances that really tackled these AI initiatives that they're looking at. So what's happening here? I think it's interesting because there was more than 70% of CIOs shared concerns about losing ground to competitors and missing out because of the IT and infrastructure gaps. I thought Cisco did a good job at talking about this, as part of the initiatives. We also saw that 96% reported their reliance on assisting AI for future-proofing the networking for the AI. So with that, Jackie, I want to start with you. There was a lot of security announcements, a lot here that talked about the importance of securing and AI and around the space. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think if you've listened to me talk in the last couple months, I've been kind of hyper-focused on the data center side of technology, AI, all of the kind of innovations happening right now in IT and security and on our ability to physically support those things via infrastructure. So it was nice to see Cisco come out and talk about, one, security at the networking level. So on integrating, security into some of the switches, the intelligent switches that they're using. ThousandEyes is now going to be GA for traffic as of next month. So I think Cisco's tackling a couple things. One is the complexity, right? So everybody's kind of rushing to try to integrate the servers for AI, which are much different than the servers for regular compute, and kind of get all of the data centers to a point where everything's working together and able to be kept cool. And I think focusing on security at the networking level is a really smart move. So I think it was nice to hear. Also, Cisco talked about enabling services, and that was another one of the things that I was going to be super focused on this year, is kind of the rise of services and how increasingly large companies are going to need some help and need to stop going it alone. So all things, I think, moving in the exact right direction with the market to support compute, security at the network level, and building out the physical infrastructure to support the compute capabilities that we're building.
Absolutely, Jackie. I mean, when I think about our conversations and our research that we're planning for 2025 and the next part of this year, there was a lot of alignment there. We talked about, you mentioned it, the zero trust network access, right? And what was happening there. That was a big part of one of the announcements around the innovation piece. What are your thoughts, Jackie, on the AI front? Like, and how that's really impacting. I think there's, from our research perspective, we're looking at, people are concerned about AI taking over their jobs and security is going to be handled by AI in the future. And I don't know about that. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think we're starting to get to there's always the hype cycle, right? Everybody's going through that. And we're starting to pass peak down into disillusionment when a lot of these projects have been deployed and been unsuccessful for a variety of reasons. So I think agentic AI has a lot to do with this whole kind of security at the network level idea, and that if you're going to have all of these agents, which is kind of like expanding your workforce, right? Because they're all doing important things with company data, things that are important that need to be monitored. And so finding a way to handle quadrupling, sometimes 10xing your workforce with AI agents, and really observe all of the traffic that's happening and all of the interactions they're having together. That's where I think you see the AI pods that Cisco's talking about, the collaboration tools, and even some of the engineering alliances. So Cisco's kind of leaning really hard into the alliances that are going to help them support all of these endeavors. So I think everybody's really focused on, it's great that we can create more custom purposed agents for AI that can achieve better outcomes, but how do we control them? How do we know what they're doing? How do we know how they're accessing the network? How do we control the other resources that they're accessing and not just end up with these blanket permissions for, say, an HR system that's not really important, it's employee PII. So I think we're going to see a lot more of security move this direction where you can't really do it at the endpoint level. You can't really, you always need detection everywhere, but to secure that number of independent agents working with data, we really do have to move kind of one level below the abstraction to the network and platform level.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, when it's moving to that level and understanding what's happening, I think that was one of the key takeaways I was hearing a lot around blueprints and reference architectures, right? When we look at, you know, Bob, I'm going to come over to you in a minute here talking about the networking side, because there was a lot of announcements around the Cisco hybrid mesh firewall. There was the agile services for networking that really added in that AI component for AI connectivity and really monetizing that assurance services. So I think there's a blueprint there that they were talking about, and also the AI server family, right? We saw that the NVIDIA piece with reference architecture and bringing that flexibility to AI workloads. All of it requires that underpinning pieces of the networking. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, absolutely, Paul. There's so much going on right now. The thing that I'm really impressed with is we're starting to see Cisco come out with an accelerated pace of innovation. And more importantly, not just within the business units, but between them. So G2 had stated that one of his top priorities was to have loosely coupled and tightly integrated solutions that leverage the entirety of the Cisco portfolio. And we're seeing that starting to take shape. So from a networking perspective, certainly you're starting to see all the tight integrations, whether it be with Hypershield or AI defense, things like that, where you're starting to see more of the security as Jackie had mentioned, right? This is getting the network the security happening at that network level is becoming more and more prevalent and driving those security functions closer to the applications. I think the other big piece of this, as you both have mentioned, is the focus on the AI area. And so from Cisco's perspective, they've addressed that from both everything from SiliconANGLE expansion, right? Trying to take that technology that they were using at the hyperscale level and driving that into the data center and into service providers. They've got new routers. They've got new smart switches, you know, looking to also drive and take advantage of the edge. They're converging some of their IP and optical. So some of the Acacia powered pluggables going up to 800 gig. And the other piece that you mentioned, which is really critical, is the Cisco validated designs, those blueprints. When we had done research earlier this year, that was the top thing that all the enterprises were asking for. It's like, hey, we get to build these new AI data center environments, but we don't have the skills. We've never done it before. So help us do that. So seeing these Cisco validated designs, seeing organizations being able to leverage the AI pods themselves and be able to leverage a lot of the networking capabilities, the hyper fabric that Cisco created. So it really fully automates and optimizes those data center fabrics for these AI environments. So those are a lot of the things that I'm starting to see. And it's great to see this continued accelerated pace of innovation and the continued integration across the business units. And as you'd mentioned as well, right, part of that is tying in with Thousand Eyes as well to have that visibility, not within the data center, but across the end-to-end environment as these AI environments will truly scale data centers, cloud, edge locations as well.
Absolutely, Bob. You know, looking at everything you're talking about, I couldn't help but think about the way Cisco was addressing the business challenges that we see in the real world. And when I say the real world, this wasn't just a product pitch, right? This was addressing those organizational challenges. You were touching on the blueprints and reducing complexity. I think that absolutely is a way that's going to address some of these application modernization challenges that we see, right? Whenever I'm talking about app modernization, I'm thinking about it in the context of past, present, and future. There's also the amplification around the integration. You mentioned Thousand Eyes Traffic Insights, right? That allows for that end-to-end assurance for the digital experience. But let's not forget about Splunk, right? There was an announcement around Splunk. And Bob, I want to come back to you on observability, right? Because when we talk about Splunk, and we talk about our research, we look at it in the context of what's the market doing and what's happening in the space, complexity, operational efficiencies, minimizing that, and skill gap issues is also a big, big challenge. What we see in our research is that 75% of our recent study, 75% of respondents in our recent study of over 800 respondents indicated that they're using 6 to 15 different observability tools to utilize or to understand the insights within their environment. This is a challenge, right? And what we're seeing is 54% of respondents are saying that in 2025, they want to replace these all these different tools in favor of a full stack observability solution, right? And that's where I think that Cisco and Splunk integration, bringing together the Splunk app dynamics and the threat intelligence that kind of tie together with Splunk security solutions, as Jackie was talking about earlier, all of that kind of ties back to that observability, understanding what's happening in the space, but also taking actionable insights across what's happening in security threat management and such. You know, Bob, what are your thoughts there on observability?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's absolutely critical. You know, when we've asked earlier this year about, especially if I just look at it from a network perspective, over 80% of the respondents to a survey said our network environment's more complex, right? And it's no surprise. If you think about what's going on now with AI, people are building out AI data centers. They've got to collect data from the edge. They want to do inferencing at all their edge locations. They've got applications, modern applications in the cloud and so forth. So there's so much going on that's driving up the complexity. Yet the interesting part was over 9 out of 10, 93% came back and said, the network is going to be more or much more important to us achieving our business goals. And so as part of that, the way that you're going to be able to ensure that the network is enabling all of these applications is having that deep visibility, that granular visibility into that end-to-end environment, so that you can not only ensure the performance of the environment so everything's optimized, but also, to Jackie's point, the security aspect and being able to look at the network as a key indicator of where there might be potential threats or vulnerabilities. So, and critical again to having that is that end-to-end granular visibility across the entire estate, whether it be in a public cloud, a colo, a private data center, an edge location, and honestly, all the way down to the end users as well.
Bob, do you think consolidation is realistic? I always giggle and say, oh, well, you know, 95% of respondents want to consolidate. Yeah, I'd like to consolidate all the appliances in my kitchen to a private chef, but I'm not going to get budget for that. And it's not realistic.
Yeah. Oh, Jackie, I'll send you a link to the Minimalist podcast if you want that. That'll help you fix all your consolidation issues. But I do want to come back to you, Jackie, on this, because, you know, Bob was talking about the real-time threat intelligence and listening to the announcements. One of the other big announcements that came up was the Cisco Talos and the availability for Splunk Enterprise Security, Splunk SOAR, and Splunk Attack Analyzer, right? These are all very much, you know, actionable insights on the observability side. But then after you find these challenges and you see that real-time threat intelligence, what do you do with it, right? And I think that that's where the Splunk security side comes into play. And Jackie, I'll give you the last word on that.
Yeah, so I think it's great to finally, post-acquisition, you know, I think one of the hardest ways to grow as a large company is acquisition, buying another large company. So we're starting to see, you know, some of the benefits of that acquisition. So the integration of, you know, Cisco Secure Application for Splunk App Dynamics, to your, like you just mentioned, Talos Threat Intelligence. So to really be able to leverage kind of the capability of these two sophisticated companies coming together, I think it's still going to take some time, but this is, as I was saying, like, to be realistic, the chances of everything becoming a platform and every customer out there choosing the best of breed platform and consolidating, it's not going to happen. So I think more of a focus on, we have all of these, you know, disparate data streams. How do we really get insights into them? And then, you know, the customers grow by acquisition as well, right? And so that always presents a challenge, is if you acquire a new company or a new technology, integrating that back into your stack. So it's good to see, you know, finally taking advantage of some of the things like Splunk SOAR, right? So there's all of these different things that I think that with the hardware and networking and infrastructure side of Cisco and all of that really valuable insight, coupled with the observability, which you need for security with Splunk. Hopefully, as they start to tie more and more of these things together, I think to your point with the frameworks, it's not always easy to figure out how to tie these things together yourself. So I keep reiterating that I would like to see vendors be more prescriptive about solutions. And this all kind of falls under that umbrella. So I can't pick it apart too badly because I think we're moving in the right direction.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, there's a fine line between prescriptive architectures and freedom of choice, right? Customer choice is a big area. And, you know, I think when we look at this, you know, it was clear to me at Cisco Live and EMEA that they were looking to solve the AI challenges, right? They were looking at doing this by addressing skill gap issues by having, you know, AI skill partner ecosystem working together with the certifications that come together, but also work with the service delivery partners. And Bob, you alluded to the fact that they're working with services and such, and that's a big area that came out of it. Also, like the AI-led customer experience. This is about their AI agents and the strategic partnerships with Mistral AI. And, you know, I really think that's an area that's going to grow. And Jackie, to your point around, you know, driving those results to that customer choice and making sure that customers are getting what they need is really a big factor. Jackie, Bob, I really want to thank you for your time today. There's a lot here, a lot to talk about. And our research note will go into a lot of details with the data that kind of backs up these comments and such. And I'm looking forward to writing that and having that published for us and looking forward for the audience to see it. I want to thank you both for your insights and your time. This is really an important event, I think, for the industry. I think that it's important that we're seeing this convergence of unified architectures, and certainly for the DevOps and app dev environment, that's a big push. And I can imagine that's reducing complexity across all areas of the business as well. I will also want to thank the audience for watching. This is just a little bit of the insights to what's happening at Cisco Live and EMEA. And for additional information, feel free to reach out to Jackie, Bob, myself, and we'd be happy to have more conversations around this topic. Thank you and have a great day.